Today on BRStv, we're going to discuss aquarium testing, what's important to test for, methods, and frequency. Testing is one of those things that seems intimidating or a pain in the butt to most people. If you get the right kits, testing can be easy, and if we make sure we're only testing for important elements, we can hone down the work considerably. I generally group test kits into four major categories: cycling, major elements, nutrients, and minor elements. When starting a brand new tank for the first time, most people will typically buy test kits related to cycling and getting the tank ready for fish. Cycling refers to the nitrogen cycle that naturally processes food and fish waste into relatively safe nitrate. The testing that goes on during the cycle typically consists of ammonia, nitrite, and nitrate. However, after that is complete and the tank is fully stocked, most people rarely test for ammonia unless they're troubleshooting an issue the tank is experiencing, and very few people will ever test for nitrite again. Our advice is to get all three if this is your first tank, so you can get more familiar with how the cycle works. However, if this is your second or third tank, just skip the nitrite kit because it doesn't add a ton of value for more experienced reefers. The ammonia kit is always important to cycling a new tank and cheap enough that it's nice to have on hand if you're ever having issues with the tank. Next is the major elements, which are calcium, alkalinity, and magnesium. Anyone who owns a reef tank should have all three of these on hand. These are all critical to maintaining proper water chemistry and providing the major elements our corals need to grow. If you're a newer reefer, we suggest testing for calcium and alkalinity every week so you can get used to how your tank consumes these elements and their relation to each other. You'll use this information to help tune your calcium and alkalinity solution, whether it be kelk washer, two-part, or a calcium reactor. Once you've honed in on how much your tank consumes, you can probably cut back to every other week before you do your water changes. You should note that alkalinity drops much faster than calcium, so if you only had time to test for one of these, we strongly suggest you select alkalinity. In fact, once you have your calcium and alkalinity replacement strategy really nailed down, it's fairly common for reefers to test for alkalinity every couple weeks and calcium less often, since these elements are consumed in roughly equal amounts and the consumption of each becomes fairly predictable. Magnesium is a bit different. It isn't used to a large degree in biological function, so it isn't consumed as rapidly, but it's equally important because its presence is what allows us to maintain high levels of calcium and alkalinity in the first place. One of the biggest sources of magnesium depletion is water changes. High-quality magnesium is one of the more expensive components in a salt mix, so it's fairly common for the cheaper mixes to intentionally have lower levels of magnesium. In fact, this might be one of the overall quality indicators of the salt mix in general. Typical ocean values are around 1300. If they're skimping here on something they know you're going to test for, it's a fairly safe assumption they're skimping in harder to identify areas as well. For that reason, it's common for most experienced reefers to either test for magnesium after they do a water change and make adjustments to the levels then, or even right in the salt mixing container itself. Either way, this is most often done with magnesium chloride. We offer a pharmaceutical-grade magnesium chloride in bulk, which makes it pretty affordable. Testing for these is typically done with some type of titration test kit where you drip the reagent into the solution until it changes color. I think one of the best values on this type of kit is a Red Sea Foundation package, which includes all three kits at a significantly reduced cost. This brand of kit loans concepts from more expensive lab type kits and includes nice equipment like these handheld titrators. For alkalinity, I personally use a colorimeter produced by Hanna. I like this unit because it's quick, the digital readout is easy to read, and I found it to be as reliable as the test kits I was using prior. In fact, in some ways, I find them to be more reliable because I don't have to rely on my ability to correctly identify and match the reagent color or precisely when the change happened like I do with most test kits. The next group of kits test the nutrients added to the tank as a result of the eventual breakdown of all the foods added to the tank. These will primarily be the nitrate and phosphate kits. Nitrate is commonly one of the end results of the nitrogen cycle and the only kit from the cycle that is tested frequently throughout the tank's natural life. There are two reasons to test for nitrate. First, nitrate is basically a plant food, so high levels of nitrate often result in a tank full of ugly algae, which no one wants. Second is, high levels of nitrate irritate fish and corals and can even kill them in some cases. Most reefers will only test for this about once a month or if they're having issues with the tank. How fast the nitrate levels rise in your tank is a direct result of the amount of food put into the tank. Getting high nitrate readings means you either need to stop feeding as much, start doing more water changes, or increase the efficiency of your other export equipment like the protein skimmer or refugium. Phosphate is also a plant food of sorts, so this is also something many people test for. The interesting thing about phosphate is there are extremely efficient medias available that can collect and remove phosphate, like GFO. If you maintain ultra-low levels of phosphate, you can often avoid algae issues even if you have high levels of nitrate and intense lighting. This effect is so pronounced that you can often get a deceptive perception that you have a really good maintenance schedule and low nutrients when your nitrates might really be off the charts. Something you may only start to notice when corals begin to brown out, lose tissue, or even die. For this reason, it's almost more important to test for nitrates when running phosphate removing media because you often won't have the visual nutrient indicator associated with algae growth. Phosphate will also slow coral growth by incorporating itself into the skeletal structure of the coral and making it harder to lay down additional calcium carbonate. For any reefer who's actively trying to grow out their corals, this might be the number one reason to test for and maintain ultra-low phosphate levels. There are various phosphate test kits available and they do work, but most of them require you to read a very light shade of blue, which many people find pretty hard. I'm one of those people. I can never say with any real confidence which one it is. Of all the options, I do find the color wheel on the Red Sea test kit to be the easiest to read, and they do sell a nice package with the nitrate and phosphate combined. That said, this is another one where I find the Hanna checker to be invaluable. The digital readout is a million times better than trying to read a shade of blue, and the test is super easy to do. Most of the other test kits fall into the minor elements category. This list includes iodine, iron, potassium, strontium, and the list goes on. While it's generally agreed that maintaining these elements is beneficial, particularly to coral coloration as well as skeletal growth, the test kits are either often hard to do or offer results of questionable value because the margin of error is so large, or the results are impossible to read. At this point, I'm sure you won't be surprised that of the available options, the Red Sea kit is going to be my personal favorite if I were to test for these elements. You'll find a potassium, iodine, and iron kit in this package. These kits are all related to their coral coloration trace element system. The one test we haven't discussed today and fairly popular is a pH test kit. I'll have to be honest and say, while I think it's probably wise to have one of these, it doesn't have a great deal of practical use. A reef tank can really operate anywhere in the 7.8 to 8.3 range, and I've seen enough tanks at a wide variety of pHs to know you can have a very successful tank anywhere in that range. That said, there are a few benefits to knowing the pH of the tank. First, it's theorized that hard corals calcify and grow faster if the tank is maintained closer to 8.3. Second, as with everything, stability is key, so knowing the pH can help make sure it's stable as possible. And lastly, if a tank falls outside the 7.8 to 8.3 range, it's a really good sign that something is wrong in the tank or with the equipment. However, a test kit is of really low value for all of these things because the pH changes so much throughout the day. You'd have to be testing all the time. To be useful, you really need to use a monitor or controller. This one from Pinpoint is probably the most popular and provides a real-time update of the tank's pH. This is also a function of most aquarium controllers like the Neptune Apex. This model even shows you a graph of the tank's pH history, which can be useful. That wraps up today's episode. This week's question of the week is, what is your favorite brand of test kit and how often do you test? Next week, we'll be going over aquarium controllers. If you'd like to be notified when it comes out, hit that subscribe button. Thank you for watching BRStv.